Good morning and welcome to worship at St David's on this Bank Holiday Sunday. And welcome to all those who are watching the video online later as well. I have only, I think, one notice to give out, which is that there is, once again, fresh produce at the back of the church. There's plums and I can see cucumbers and possibly something else. So thank you very much to the people who brought those fresh produce, but please do also go and have a look and take something away with you because we all need the fresh food to be eaten. And a thank you ought to be said to all those who've helped with the trees and hedges around the St David's grounds this week. We've had people up at various times done a lot of good work on trimming those back. So thank you very much for all those who've been here and helped, and a number of people who aren't here this morning have helped. And now I shall hand over to Marje Robinson to lead our worship. Thank you, Marje.
Well, good morning, everybody. It feels like a very long time since I was here. I think it must be pre-pandemic. So lovely to see you all. So we'll begin with our call to worship. Everyone is a member of God's family. Look around you. Go on, look around you. Look at the others. Different ages, different hair colours, different genders, different clothes, with and without glasses, with and without hearing aids, with and without walking aids. With freckles, I've got some here, with freckles, without freckles, with different outlooks on life, and yet all of us are children of God. We're loved unconditionally by him, and all of us are special to him. So let us feel loved and contented as we begin our service. So we'll begin by singing the hymn. So we'll begin by singing As We Are Gathered, Jesus Is Here. And we'll sing it through twice, please. Shall we now come together in prayer? We begin with a prayer of praise. In your presence, in this place, We come to you, Almighty God. You are the reason for our being and our being here. You are the one who created us, who breathed life into us. You are the giver of love, the welcomer to all. Almighty God, as we gather, we are humbled by your greatness, by your generosity and justice. Together, we offer you our prayers for who you are and what you are. You are the God we praise and adore. Amen. And saying sorry. We are sorry, Lord, for repeatedly getting things wrong. We know you love us as we are, yet depending on circumstances, we are not always like this with others. We pick and choose who we will include for fun things, for chats, for coffee, for help in difficult tasks, for who we support, for who we give our money and time to, who we are pleased to see, and who we avoid. We are so very human and need your help on a daily basis to live your way. Thank you, Lord, for helping us and remind us that we only need to ask for your help and it will be given. And our assurance that we are forgiven. Just remember the words of Jesus when he said, "For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son, that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life." Amen. And shall we now say together the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Shall we now sing again? Tell out my soul.
To me, the
look around you again. What a lovely lot of people you are. Well, why are you sitting where you are sitting today? What's the reason? Are you sitting with a friend? Are you sitting in a family group? Oh, I'm your friend, don't worry, Irene. Maybe you're sitting where you can hear better. Maybe you're sitting somewhere where you can see better. Maybe you're sitting where you are because you don't want to be near somebody else. It happens in some churches. Maybe you're sitting in a place that's a warm spot in winter. Hard to imagine it being cold at the moment, isn't it? Maybe you're near the door so that if you get bored, you can slip out and I perhaps won't notice. Who knows? But have a look at this photograph now. Supposing I told you that I'm just going to disappear off and she's going to lead worship instead, what would you be thinking? Wouldn't bother you. Okay. Same person. She does lead worship. I'd like to tell you about her because looking at that photograph of her, some people would take one look and dismiss that person, wouldn't they? Some people would. I'm not saying you would, but some people would. She's called the Reverend Nadia Boltz Weber. She's 6'1" tall, a former stand-up comic and now a competitive weightlifter. But when she isn't down at the gym working out, tattoo-covered Nadia is a Lutheran pastor. I swear like a truck driver, she said. I refuse to pretend I'm somebody I'm not. So the Reverend Nadia Boltz Weber, who has experimented with Wicca, is now the pastor of All Saints and Sinners. Sorry, the other way around. All Sinners and Saints. And that's a Lutheran church in Denver, Colorado. While normal church events might end with the congregation blessing themselves on the way out, this church prefers to have a dance party featuring a chocolate fountain in the baptismal font. I wouldn't mind that. So, despite her alternative approach and her quirky sermons, which are littered with profanities, it's worked. Her congregation is growing and hundreds of people now peer out from among the pews in her church listening to her. We're all about Jesus, but to have humour and lightness and irreverence is our version of piety, she says. Nadia Boltz Weber started getting tattoos when she was 17, but the ones on her arms are mainly religious. She has the church year down one arm and images which include Advent, Christmas, Lent, Good Friday, and Pentecost on the other arm. She says, in a way, my arms are like the stained glass in a medieval cathedral. They are pedagogical. And yeah, no, I didn't know what pedagogical means. But I looked it up. It means a way of teaching. You see, am I teaching or am I leading worship? Well, I'm telling you something, aren't I? Words, pictures, two methods. Later on, I think I've got one action included. And we've got some laughter. So it's different ways of teaching. So she's saying, I don't want to say that word again. How many times do people ask you in a coffee shop about the Christian faith? I can't remember the last time that happened with me. I guess you're the same. It happens all the time for me. People will say things like, oh gosh, what do your tattoos mean? They're beautiful. And then I'm telling them the story of Jesus. It's a no-brainer. As a teenager, she felt that she never quite belonged and turned to drinks and drugs for about a decade, but she says she never stopped believing in God. And it was during her recovery that she met Lutheran seminary students training to be a pastor called Matthew Weber, who brought her back to the church. They married in 1996. They have a boy and a girl, and she trained to be a pastor. Now, I've told you her story because there's a meaning behind it. Now, I know you are a responsive church. Would anybody like to say what the meaning is?
Responsive.
We are?
Responsive.
Yes, you are responsive, because you've just spoken. What's the meaning behind that story? Don't judge. Thank you. Don't judge. And even if someone's going off the rails at part of their lives, who knows what will happen to them in the future? So, we now come to our Bible readings. We have two, Psalm 112 and Luke 14. So, thank you to our readers.
First reading is Psalm 112. Praise the Lord. How joyful are those who fear the Lord and delight in obeying his commands. Their children will be successful everywhere. An entire generation of godly people will be blessed. They themselves will be wealthy, and their good deeds will last forever. Light shines in the darkness for the godly. They are generous, compassionate, and righteous. Good comes to those who lend money generously and conduct their business fairly. Such people will not be overcome by evil. Those who are righteous will be long remembered. They do not fear bad news. They confidently trust the Lord to care for them. They are confident and fearless and can face their foes triumphantly. They share freely and give generously to those in need. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. They will have influence and honor. The wicked will see this and be infuriated. They will grind their teeth in anger. They will slink away, their hopes thwarted. Amen.
Reading verse 1, then 7 to 14, and can be found in the Pew Bibles on page 1047. I am reading from the New Living Bible translation. One Sabbath day, Jesus went to eat dinner in the home of a leader of the Pharisees, and the people were watching him closely. When Jesus noticed that all who had come to the dinner were trying to sit in the seats of honor near the head of the table, he gave them this advice. When you are invited to a wedding feast, don't sit in the seat of honor. What if someone who is more distinguished than you has also been invited? The host will come and say, "Give this person your seat." Then you will be embarrassed, and you will have to take whatever seat is left at the foot of the table. Instead, take the lowest place at the foot of the table. Then when your host sees you, he will come and say, "Friend, we have a better place for you." For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who are humble themselves will be exalted. Then he turned to his host. "When you put on a luncheon or a banquet," he said, "don't invite your friends, brothers, relatives, and rich neighbors, for they will invite you back, and that will be your only reward. Instead, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. Then at the resurrection of the righteous, God will reward you for inviting those who could not repay you." May God add his blessings to these readings from his holy word.
Thank you to our two readers. Shall we now sing again? We will sing Meekness and Majesty. Which I use for the theme introduction I'm using for the message is quite deliberate. That's the shingle beach, and that's quite a rare poppy. Is it the yellow horned poppy?
Yes.
Thank you. I knew the expert was sitting there. Oh, she's sitting there. and this is a shingle beach off the coast of Hythe in South Kent. Now, I picked up three of the shingle. Can you see that's got a hole in it? Locally, that was always called a witch stone. Don't know why, presumably because only a witch could make a hole in a stone. I liked that one because of its shape and its colour. And that one, if I show it you this way, doesn't look impressive, but if I turn it over, anyone know what it is? Flint, yeah. Now, all that shingle there, it's made from different rocks. They were made at different times, millions of years ago. Different colours, different hardnesses, but they are all important because they protect the town of Hythe and a lot of the other little settlements along the south coast. They protect them from the high tides. And of course, we know that the sea levels are rising. The water comes up, percolates downwards through the stones, protects the town. And that's what I want to be talking about now. How it doesn't matter who you are, what you look like, whether you've got freckles or not. It just doesn't matter. We are all important. So let's have a look at this Luke reading and have a look at what it tells us. But first of all, a little bit about the social conventions of the time. So everyone who was anyone would expect to be invited to meals and in return would invite all the folk of high standing to their meals. Table would be U-shaped and the host would sit there. He could see everybody who was there. So he was in the middle. And next to him, on either side, would be the two people with the highest social status of all the visitors. And then a bit lower social status, a bit lower, a bit lower. And the ones with the lowest social status were at the end, furthest distance from the host. That was what you did. That was the culture of the time. Now, we weren't told in that reading where Jesus was assigned a seat, but I would guess it was somewhere fairly close to the host. He was a leader of the Pharisees. And the Pharisees, by this stage of Jesus' ministry, were seeking to catch Jesus out. So he was invited on a Sabbath day. Now, according to the law of Moses, the Torah, no work on the Sabbath day. So Jesus was being watched, and he had form. What we didn't hear in our Luke reading were the verses preceding, where a man with dropsy, we would call it oedema nowadays, was there, and Jesus had healed him. And that was significant because dropsy, as it was called in the Bible, oedema, as we call it now, you retain water. And in those days, in that culture, if you were fat, you were greedy. So people with dropsy, as they called it, were disliked and hated because if you were fat, you were greedy. Now, that wasn't the case because it was an illness. So what have we got? We've got Pharisees, we've got Jesus, and we've got the Sabbath day. A situation asking for conflict, and Jesus was not one to disappoint. So after watching the guests arriving and trying to get all the top seats at the table, remember, here next to the host, he threw his first spanner in the works. "Sit at the far end of the table," he said. "When the host notices you, he'll move you up," he said. "Much better than being told to move to the bottom of the pile," he said. "If that happened, you would be shamed and dishonored," he said. Now, we don't talk about honour very much, do we? But in some groups of people, honour is more important even than family. And you'll reflect that now and again you hear in the news that a daughter, it's usually a daughter, occasionally a man, but usually a daughter or a woman, has been killed because she's gone off with a non-Muslim or a non-Hindu or whatever, and she's brought dishonour to the family, so she gets killed. Now, we don't do that. We don't talk about honour in that way, but this was the situation at the time. So was Jesus making a practical suggestion? Well, maybe, but probably not. Because he says, or he said, "For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." Now, this was a huge dig at the so-called hoi polloi, who completely misread how to lead a holy life. Your status is irrelevant to God. It was irrelevant. It remains irrelevant. God expects us all, then and now, to live as closely as we can to following his ways, as modelled by Jesus. Jesus was pointing out that following God's way for a holy life did not include climbing up on the backs of others to get a top social status. Social one-upmanship was not part of the law of Moses, the Torah. As Pharisees, they should have known what it says in Proverbs 25, 6 to 7. It says, "Do not exalt yourself in the king's presence, and do not claim a place among his great men. It is better for him to say to you, 'Come up here,' than for him to humiliate you before his nobles." They'd obviously forgotten that, or chose to not listen. But aren't we sometimes like that? I must admit, some of these things I've said myself. I'm a better cook than he is. Why is he doing it? Her washing up after the coffee is rubbish. You can still see all the stains around the cup. Why was he chosen ahead of me? I'm better than he is. If she gets promotion ahead of me, I'm never going to speak to her ever again. Yes, is that ringing some bells? Certainly does for me, I regret to say. God's kingdom doesn't work like this, though. If we serve our Saviour faithfully without looking for rewards or favours in this world, we will earn a much better reward at the end of our lives. And that reward will be living eternally with our triune God, with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. So, Pharisees, Jesus, Sabbath day. Jesus hadn't finished yet. It was now time for his second spanner in the works. He turned his attention to his host, a leader of the Pharisees, by questioning why he only invited high-status people to his meals. Because in the culture of the time, as opposed to the law of Moses, you only invited folk who would pay you back. Jesus didn't mince his words. "You'll only get a worldly reward for this," he said. "Invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind," he said. Invite those where the giving is one way only, he said. Be generous to those who have nothing or have disabilities that exclude them from work and from society, he said. You will be blessed if you do this, he said. You will be repaid at the resurrection of the blessed, he said. I wonder what any of the Pharisees in the room were thinking at this stage, because the Pharisees did believe in resurrection. The Sadducees didn't, but the Pharisees did. Now, a question for you. Do you believe that you will start a new life with our God when you leave this earth? Even if you do, then only expect an earthly reward if you are only kind to people who can and will thank you. But if you help where you can with no thought of rewards, not even a thank you maybe, if you show true humility, as Jesus said, you will receive your reward from God when you are resurrected to be with him. Easier said than done, of course. What does it mean in practice? Well, if you are lucky enough to have the time or the money to give freely, do you pick and choose depending on how you judge people? Do you decide that helping the dropouts of society is unappealing compared with, say, cancer research, because far too many members of your family have been affected by cancer? If you've got limited time and money, it's a difficult choice, isn't it? It really is. Now, so far, I have suggested to you that humility and including everyone is God's way of living. But if everyone is included, that means you are included too. So we now have a little light-hearted dialogue with a serious meaning for you, well, for all of us. So I'm going to invite God to join me. Now, God this morning is very heavily disguised as Bethan, but she's God. Hey, God.
Hello, my love.
It's not even lunch and I've already fallen to pieces.
Well, that's totally fine. It makes you look like a mosaic.
Oh. I just wish my life was more put together.
I don't.
Why not?
Because I like puzzles. I can help if you'd like.
Oh, that would be great. Here's the cover of my puzzle box. You can use the picture as a guide to show us how my life is supposed to look like.
Oh, we won't need that. Your puzzle isn't ever going to look anything like that puzzle.
Really? Ooh.
Sorry, your life doesn't have the puzzle pieces to make a picture like that.
Okay, fine. What's next then? Should we find all the edge pieces of my puzzle so we can build its frame?
Well, actually, we're going to throw out all the edges and border pieces. We won't need them.
Well, how will I know where my boundaries are?
You don't have any. Your life has infinite possibilities.
But I don't understand. Without boundaries, I don't know which way to build.
Exactly.
Exactly? What? do I know when I'm done putting myself together?
There is no done. Your puzzle won't ever be finished.
Oh, that's discouraging.
Well, I think it's exciting.
I wanted my life to look like the person on the cover of my puzzle box. This is how it's supposed to look.
Nobody looks like that. Everybody is constantly shuffling their pieces together. Nobody is ever finished. It is the joyful work of a lifetime.
Wait. My pieces won't even fit together. There are hardly any matches. How am I going to get this thing to stay together with all of these jagged pieces?
Well, that's where I come in. I'm the glue.
The glue? This is going to get really messy.
I can wait.
Well, we're going to need a bigger table than that. Thank you, God. Not very helpful, though. Well, amusing. Well, I hope it was to you. But did you get the very clear message that whoever and whatever you are, God loves you as you are? Now, in almost all circumstances, we are our worst critics, aren't we? We know our faults better than anyone, except God. But you see, God just sees us as fascinating creatures as we make our way through our lives. And I suspect that some of you, like me, must have times when God is saying, "Oh my goodness, why is that happening?" Yeah? Anyway, finally, like me, by the time you've chatted with friends over refreshments and gone home, you'll have no idea whatsoever what this message was about. But if you can, take home these thoughts, even if you remember nothing else. First one. God loves you. The real you. Not the person you sometimes present yourself as in public. The real you. He loves you. Stay low key. You don't need a high status. Live your best at all times and with all people, even when it's difficult. And if you do these, God will see your life and reward you with eternal life. So as it says in the verses 1, 2, and 9 in Psalm 112, "Praise the Lord. How joyful are those who fear the Lord and delight in obeying his commands. Their children will be successful everywhere. An entire generation of godly people will be blessed. They share freely and give generously to those in need. Their good deeds will be remembered forever." Amen. Now, at the end of this hymn, the offertory will be brought for a prayer. So shall we now sing, "Let us talents and tongues employ."
Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around.
Loving God, we thank you for these monetary gifts, some of which will be given with difficulty as the cost of living rises so worryingly. Most of all, we thank you for this church family that gives its talents and times, showing your love to this earth and everything on it and in it. Amen. Now we come to our prayers of concern. I was reading the Mersey Synod, reading on the Mersey Synod website on Friday, and I found a prayer written by Andy Braunston, the Minister for Digital Worship for the United Reformed Church. And I'd written my prayers of intercession, or prayers of concern. I read his, which is specifically for today, ditched mine, so you're going to hear his. Much better. So shall we pray? Eternal One, in these days of sunshine and rain, of refreshing breeze and lazy afternoons, as many prepare to go back to school, and as thousands prepare to head to university or the world of work, we praise and give you thanks for all that is good in our lives. For those we love, whether family or friends, for those whose company we enjoy, for the beauty that surrounds us in the created order, for the random acts of kindness we see day by day, and for all that adds value and worth to our living. Lord Jesus, you often told the rich off for ignoring the poor. You weren't a great guest at dinner parties, rebuking the host for the guest list, telling folk not to grab the best seats and to give without any hope of earthly reward. We lift to you, dear Lord, all who are desperate in these days, who already struggle to pay their bills, who are in deep panic about the coming power rises, and who cannot make any further savings and will go cold and hungry this winter. Holy Spirit, you are the creative spark which sets us ablaze. You are the warmth of love that leads us to serve the poor. You are the fire in our bellies that leads us to cry for justice. Inspire, we beg you, those who aspire to lead our nations to work for justice, to be creative with reforming our broken energy markets, and to offer relief to all who dread the coming months, that none may go cold or hungry this winter. Eternal One, in the midst of our praises and our prayers, we're worried. Worried about our own bills. Worried about our church's bills. Worried about how the groups who use our church will be able to afford to continue. Worried about how we can make a difference in these difficult times. Keep us ever alive to your Spirit. Allow us to find ways to open our doors and our hearts to your promptings, to unleash our resources of time, talent, and treasure, that none may go cold or hungry this winter. We remember before you now all those known to us in any form of need. And we think especially of the people known by others in this church. Martin, Heather, Karen, Joe. Emma, Doreen, Brian. Martin and Kathy. Neil and Dawn. David, Mary, Jackie. Carol, Ellie, Pat. Alan, Sarah, Bev, Marge, Ray, Marty, and Margaret Kellogg on her birthday. We bring all these prayers to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We now come to our final hymn. I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. Shall we really enjoy singing this final hymn? To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.